Hi, brother.
I wanted to share something quickly with you that the board had shown me yesterday. I was going to the line of government, and but on my way on Yosemite, there's a lot of people that are addicted. You know, I see people that I've seen that I know walking around with bags, and you know, they're obviously pressed, right? So I pray for those people every time I pass by them. My heart breathes for them. Well, out of the blue, I was in the line at McDonald's, and the Lord just gave me a vision. Like, I saw the glory of the Lord.
Yeah, amen.
That's because he's not a goosebump, guys.
Right.
Nope, not a Jesus is a presence.
Thank you,
the
Father.
Glory of the Lord is over the city to set the captive free.
Amen.
There will be deliverance in the streets.
Yes, Father.
Amen.
I mean, manifestation of the glory of the Lord. Because the Lord told me, give me another scripture. I will go with you and I will give you rest. Well, that was the angel of his presence. But there's glory over the city right now. Engage with it. Believe you receive it. I'm just saying, you're going to see people that you would have never thought would be free from this habit, and they're going to die in the streets or whatever the Lord says, I'm setting the cap. Lord, because of him, no man will be glory for it but him.
That's right.
That goes right along with what Ron was singing earlier, or talking about earlier, and of course that. And here, about 2 weeks ago, I read a prophecy that Dad had gave back in 2004 about the glory of the Lord, the glory of God. The people will see the glory of God hovering over this city in the future, and that a mighty demon revival will take place in Madera, and that those things are coming. I've been... And some of us here as well, too, I could mention some names and stuff, but for years now, I mean, over a decade, probably 15 years or so, that's all that's on the inside of me when I think about ministry is the healing revival in the city, the days of glory. That's what the Lord spoke to me over there during praise and worship. I forgot about that. He brought back to me. He told me we're in the days of glory. Tell the people we're in the days of glory. And so it goes right along with what Tammy said. And so that's all I think about is healing revival in Madera. All I think about is people getting healed on the streets. All I think about is people just being healed, sitting in meetings. All I think about is like the anointing of Peter. It was on him as he walked by. The presence of God was on him. And people were touched by the presence of the Lord. Yes. And devils came out, people were healed, sickness and disease left people. You know, sickness and disease is a devil anyway. It's from the devil, right?
Yeah.
It's not from God. God don't give us sickness and disease. Now, I know there's sometimes where we allow sickness and disease in our lives because of decisions, or maybe because we've opened the door, or maybe just because we're not taking care of ourselves like we should, health-wise or whatever. But the devil will take advantage of that and try to kill us. With that, so sickness and disease is not of God.
Yeah.
Amen. Jesus hung on the cross, gave his life so we can have health and have life more abundantly. Amen.
Yeah.
So we got to deal with things personally on a personal level between you and the Lord, and only you know what's going on in your life and your heart. But, you know, we are in the days of glory, and that's all I think about is the glory of God coming into our city and touching people, and people getting saved and healed and delivered.
Yes.
Devils leaving people, amen. People's families being restored because of the curses on their life or some kind of deal that's been going on. That is my ministry. That's all I think about. And that's all I really pray about, to be honest with you. And so I understand what Tammy said. I understand what Ron said earlier about the days of Elijah and that fire, that mantle, that prophetic mantle. That's the two things that are real strong here at our church, is a prophetic mantle and a healing mantle. Amen? And I've watched people over the years, ever since that's been spoken, prophesied over this church, people that grab a hold of that and move in that, it stirs in their life and things, fruit manifests in their life and other people's lives during their daily walk with Christ, not just at church. Amen? So if you get a hold of that and believe by faith, and maybe you need to study some of those things out. Maybe you need to study out healing. Maybe you need to study out how to lay hands on the sick. Maybe you need to read examples of the apostles and the different people in there, the prophets and different things, where they prophesied and heard God and all that. You know, start seeking God for that kind of stuff. He wants you to know what to do.
Amen.
And He wants to teach you how to do it.
Yes.
And it's really not hard. It's really just being open to the Lord. And then once He starts to use you in a certain vein or a certain area or a certain way, you just stick with that.
There you go.
Exactly.
That's a good
You know, don't try to make it more than it is or bigger than it is. Just say yes to the Lord and follow His direction. And you'll start to recognize. See, the thing is, a lot of folks ask, well, how do you know when God speaks to you? Well, it's hard to explain that to people because He does it just a certain way to me, and that's the only way I know how He does it.
Amen.
How I hear Him. He might do it in another way. He might do it just strictly through dreams with you. He might do it strictly through visions with you. He might just do it strictly through Him, you know, you just hearing His audible voice, or you just hearing on the inside. That's how it works with me. I just hear, and it's my voice that I hear. See, and then you hear it on the inward man, the inward witness, and the Holy Spirit on the inside of you. That's how I hear it. And I'll just be going along, and all of a sudden I'll hear a word. And it's like, okay, Lord. You know, yesterday I was in here vacuuming. You know? And I heard a word. I'm going to deliver it later. A word of knowledge. I'll give it later when it's the right time to give it. It's not the right time now. But I'll give it later. But you just hear that on the inside.
Yeah.
And so, honestly, guys, we're not worms in the dirt. We are holy.
Amen.
Oh, that's a good word right there.
The glory, anointing, presence of the kingdom of heaven, if you love the Lord and you're following Him, it's on you. And it's in you.
Amen.
And the whole wild thing about it is you should have a desire to let it out.
Yeah.
Wherever you're at. Whatever you constantly find yourself thinking about concerning the Lord, I say dive into that because that's probably your ministry in the way that God wants to use you.
Yeah. Get excited about that. Amen.
You know, study the fivefold ministry gifts there. You know, the prophet, the evangelist, the pastor, the teacher. Prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher, apostle.
Apostle,
prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher.
There you go.
If I say it in the order I've always heard it, I get it right off the bat. But if I say it backwards like I tend to do all the time, I have to think for a second. I've always heard my dad say the apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher.
Yeah.
But you flow in one of those.
Yeah, this church does,
yes. One of those there, God has called you to flow in.
Yeah.
And, you know, I believe a lot of folks here have understood that, and you're seeking God for that, and you're open to the Holy Spirit. This church is hard to go to if you're not open to the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I mean, if you just want to, you know, come in a quick sermonette and you're out of there, you know, it's hard to go to this church because that's not really how it works here, really, and that's okay. But, you know, if you're open to the Holy Spirit, you love to come here, and you enjoy coming here because the Holy Spirit speaks to you. Amen. I mean, I thank God for this body of Christ. I thank God for you, and I thank God for our pastors. And I thank God for the people around here because, man, you know, it saved my life, to be honest with you.
Amen.
You know, and a good local church can save your life, really, to be honest with you, man. You know, because when you go to the right local church, you know, the Lord will always confront you. The Holy Spirit will always confront you. Sometimes we need to be confronted. Sometimes we're big old babies and we need to get our butts spanked sometimes. And God will chasten us. Because He loves us. And there was years where He chasing me, whipped me.
Yeah.
And I finally came to my senses, my spiritual senses, and said, I better make that change, you know? And He's like, it's about time, Mike, so let's move on now, you know? I've whipped you for 5 years, I'm ready to take you into something now. You finally are listening to me, you know what I mean?
Yep.
So we're all called to do what God has for us. He's predestined us, He's called us to promote His womb, and we can sit here and name all these scriptures and go over all that. But we are called, and God wants us to move in the 9 gifts of the Spirit. He wants His body to flow in those gifts.
Come on, Mike.
Okay, we'll get into that in a second, but you'll notice there when we read here in a minute that it's as the Spirit wills that He wants us to flow in those things. I see a lot of folks talking about this, and I don't really agree with it, and that's okay. And maybe I'm wrong. If I'm wrong, I want the Holy Spirit to teach me and show me, because I don't want to be wrong. But I think if we try to make something happen, it usually fails. I mean, I can stand here and just think as a pastor and how my mind works. My mind works and thinks about, when I get into the pastoral, I think about the people. And I think about what's going on in the community, and I think about what's going on in our body here in this local ministry, and you guys, and all that. And it's my mind starts to run, well, what if we do this? How about we do this? How about we try this? How about, you start thinking about all this kind of stuff. But see, when we try to do something on our own, just because we think it's a good idea, a lot of times it doesn't work. But when it's a God idea, when God puts it on the inside of us, and we step out by faith and we do what God's told us to do, guys, there's going to be major, major fruit come out of that. Yeah. Amen? And so He wants us to move and flow in those nine gifts, amen? And see, there's not a lot of teaching on the nine gifts. And, you know, a lot of people, there's a lot of Christians that don't believe in the gifts of the Spirit. They believe they died with the apostles, and I've never read and never heard Jesus say that they died when the apostles died. I've never seen any of that proven in Scripture, amen? Right. All I see is that we are told, now let's just go there, 1 Corinthians chapter, actually let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 14 first, real quick. I want you to see something here, and I kind of feel like teaching just a little bit today, and that's kind of funny because that's weird for me. And I feel uncomfortable when I teach sometimes, but the Holy Spirit will teach through me, amen? And that's the way it needs to be, because man, believe me, I'm not a teacher. But when the Holy Spirit wants to do something, He'll do it right, praise the Lord. 1 Corinthians chapter 14, look at verse 1. 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 1 says this, pursue love. Pursue love and desire spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy. Now, we will not flow the way we need to flow or operate the way we need to operate or even operate to the power that God wants us to operate in if we don't pursue love. If we don't pursue God. God is love, amen? If we don't pursue God, if we don't keep our heart right and keep our heart in check with loving one another or with loving, period, we will struggle and we will not have the fruitfulness that God wants us to have concerning the spiritual gifts. See, it's very hard to operate in the spiritual gifts without love. Because, and I'll tell you, because you'll try to put your own spin on things, you'll try to do your own thing. So listen, if you're pursuing love, you're pursuing God. If you're pursuing love, you're pursuing the heart of God. Because God is love, amen? And I'll tell you right now, I've been taught this over the years growing up, that listen, you got to be very careful if you're going to be responsible for helping people. Let me tell you something. All of you are responsible to help people. Jesus said he'd leave the 99 just to get the one. Just to get the one brought into the kingdom. Amen. All of us in here at least, have one that God's going to use you to bring into the kingdom.
Yeah. Yes,
and many more. I know a lot of us in here have brought way more into the kingdom than just one person. And that's a good thing. But see, if we don't understand the love of God, if we don't understand relationship with the Father, He'll use us still. But listen, there's something more greater than when we start to understand who the love is. Keep your heart right. Keep your heart in love. Keep your heart in love with God and keep your heart in love with people. Yeah. Just be honest with yourself. Be honest with God. Be honest with yourself, guys. That's how you grow quick.
Right.
It's just like that plant that you got, man, that sunflower. You water that thing, it's going to grow and flourish to how it wants to grow or how it needs to grow and how it desires to grow. Same thing with God. Keep your heart watered in love. As soon as you have the opportunity to get out of love, even if you do get out of love and you blow it, you say something, be quick to repent and be quick to make it right, man. That's one thing that I have really put to a practice in my life. Because I get bent out of shape. I get mad. I get angry. I say things. I react certain ways and all that. But I've learned how to really correct myself and get back over into that spirit of love and make things right before the Lord in my heart. Why? What does that do? It slams the door on the devil from him coming in and wreaking all kinds of hell in your life. And that's the truth. That's the truth, guys. So pursue love, desire, and then he says, pursue love and desire spiritual gifts, especially that you may prophesy. All you guys prophesy sometimes and you don't even know you're prophesying.
Exactly.
I was talking to a man here a few weeks ago, and I didn't even know I was prophesying to him, and he just looked astounded after I said this thing, and he said, you just prophesied to me, and that's called double confirmation, and I need to take that and run, do with that. He was telling me about a situation, how he was kind of in a relationship with a lady, and he said he felt like, he said he just wasn't sure about it and all, and I looked at him, and before I knew what I was saying, because I normally never tell people anything about relationships unless they really ask me. But I was standing there, and I go, run. I said that before I realized I said, I should have said, I apologized to him. It just came out of me.
Yeah.
Why do you hear something like that? And he kind of, that's double confirmation, guy. That's exactly what I needed to hear. And I'm like, okay. I didn't feel the heavenly presence. I didn't feel the heavy anointing, the weighty glory. I didn't feel any of that. I didn't see gold dust. I didn't see anything. Didn't see a light. I just go, run. That's all I told him. But that was a prophetic word to him that day. He needed to hear that. It was double confirmation. Because he told me, he said he heard the exact words from the Lord a couple days before. Isn't that funny how that works sometimes? But we are prophetic, guys.
Yes, we are.
We really are.
Yes.
Just talking to somebody, man, you can be so profound in him, and a lot of times people won't say anything to you about it. So don't count that out.
That's true.
Because it's true. You find yourself talking to your neighbor, just be open and be honest before the Lord as you're talking to him. Because the Lord, I guarantee you, the Lord more than likely will have you say something to that person that's going to affect their life.
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
And you'll find them coming back. Ding dong.
Right.
For more. Until one day they'll probably bring them into the kingdom, or someone else will, or they'll repent and get back right with the Lord, or something like that.
Yeah.
God's using me in a situation like that right now personally. Amen? So just be open to that. So pursue love. Now look over here at chapter 12, 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Many of us have read these scriptures before and all that. We've seen them. But I believe we're at a time now, and the gifts of the Spirit have always been in operation. God's always wanted them to be in operation. And there's been times over, you know, the decades and the centuries and things like that where they've been explosive more than normal and things like that. And I really believe we're in a time now where they're really explosive.
Yeah.
And I really believe that we're in a time right now that if you, as an individual in the body of Christ, will find your niche, will find where you function, we'll find out and stop telling yourself, it's just me, it's just me. It's not just you. Some of you are hearing very specific things from the Lord, and you think it's you. And you're kind of just, it's just the way I'm thinking. No. Ask the Lord, what is that, Lord? Are you talking to me? See, He wants us to ask. When I hear a word of knowledge, I don't just say, okay, I ask him, is there more on that word, Lord, that needs to be done or said? And if there is, he'll tell me. If there isn't, there isn't. You know, ask him for more. Ask him for more knowledge. Ask him for more wisdom in that thing that he has you flowing in strongly.
Amen.
Come on, guys. Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen. Search it out.
Search it out. So it says here in chapter 12, verse 1, 1 Corinthians, now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I do not want you to be ignorant. You know that you were Gentiles carried away to these dumb idols. However, you were led. Therefore, I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus accursed. And no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by or in the Holy Spirit. There are 9 diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are differences of ministries, but the same Lord. Did you hear that? There's differences of ministries,
yeah,
but the same Lord.
Yes.
Some of you flow really strong in some gifts and some stuff that I don't. And that's a good thing. So I pay attention to that, and I try to listen to that for help in my own life. You know, we have ministries. We have things. God, listen, I believe that God will put you in a specific place, maybe in the city or even a specific job or a specific piece of land or something for your ministry so He can use you, that you'll be open to Him, and He can use you in that place, that to whatever capacity He needs to use you in. Now see, we need to start thinking that way. We need to start thinking that our life is prophetic.
Yeah.
We need to start thinking that we're not just here because Mom and Dad had a wild night. And they might have. And there's nothing wrong with it. Mom and Dad having a wild night. Married couples need that. Amen. Praise God. We need that. God created that. God created that for husband and wife, and He created it to reproduce, populate the earth. Praise God.
Amen.
That's all biblical. Nothing to worry about, none of that kind of stuff. But you're not here just because of that. You're here for a purpose, guys. You're here for a specific person or persons that God wants you to help. That's the truth. We need to start being kingdom-minded. What's the kingdom of heaven doing right now? Well, they're worshiping a lot. They're full of joy a lot. They're glad. They're happy.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen?
Yeah.
There's people up there that are praying for you. The cloud of witnesses are praying for us. They're cheering us on.
Yeah.
They're praying. You've got relatives that are up there, yeah, that are calling out your name, praying for you, that God will, that you'll be used and fulfill what God's called you to do. There's all kinds of activity going on there. But see, they're kingdom-minded, obviously, because they're there. But we can be kingdom-minded here. And the closer we get to the Father, the more kingdom-minded we get, and the more we want to reach out and help those that need help. There's something, there's a difference between just wanting to help somebody and being spirit-led in helping somebody. And both of them are great. It's good to have, when you look upon somebody that's sick, that's wonderful that you have compassion for them. God can use that compassion to minister love and healing and peace to that person. And we can do that by faith. We can do that, and we know God will show up. We know God will love them, and God will help them. We'll release, at least we'll release peace into their life. If they can get a taste of the Lord, maybe that'll change their life or something. But there's something about being Spirit-led and listening to the Holy Spirit and being directed to a person. That, there's two different things. There's power on both, but there's even more power on it when it's a word from the Lord.
Amen.
Hey man, I'm standing here blowing myself away how I'm teaching this today. I didn't know I even understood this. It's good to me. I'm listening to it myself. Listen to it. I will. But I love that. There are differences in ministries, but the same word. Verse 6. And there are diversities of activities, but it is the same God who works all in all. Verse 7. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one. Say, it's given to me.
Amen.
For the profit of all. It's given to each one for the profit of all. That gift that's given to you, that vein that you flow in, that you find yourself stronger in than maybe some of the other gifts, that gift's given to you, not just for you, but for me.
Amen.
For all.
Really?
I need to receive from that gift. I need to look at who you are in the spirit realm, not really who you are in the natural realm. There's things about you guys I like in the natural realm about you, and there's things I like about you in the spirit realm as well.
Amen.
If that makes sense.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
And the awesome thing about God is when His supernatural comes upon your natural,
yeah,
that turns you into another person. does.
Right.
We need his super on our natural, guys.
Yeah.
Even the less, lowest supernatural that you can get is better than your natural. What is the supernatural? The supernatural is God manifesting in the natural to cause things to change.
Yeah.
Your mouth, your words change areas, change situations, changes. I can walk into my living room at home, and my boys or my kids are sitting in there, and they're sitting there. I can walk in there and scream and yell at them like a banshee, and be angry and throw stuff, and it'll change the mood that they were in. And that whole atmosphere will fear, will fill with fear and anger. I can walk into that room and say, "Hallelujah, glory, we worship you, we praise you, we thank you, God." And I'll get a smile out of them, and they'll laugh. They might even join in, but it'll fill that living room with the atmosphere of love and praise and worship to the Lord and excitement and joy. I know those are simple examples, and a lot of us understand that, but that's how powerful and the prophecy is. Your words are prophetic.
Yeah.
Huh?
Right.
And God is so awesome because he'll give you a dream or a vision, or he'll say something to you, like maybe 5, 6, 10, 12, 15 years before what he just showed you is even going to manifest.
Yeah.
Why does he do that? Because he wants us to start speaking it.
Yeah.
And getting it out into the atmosphere. I'm not a scientist and I don't understand any of that kind of stuff, but I've heard that when you say things, there's actual, I don't know, what is it, particles, matter, or what is it, that comes out of your mouth and is released into the atmosphere and stays.
Germs.
No, I've not germs, but I've actually heard that to where when we say something, we release something scientifically.
Yeah.
And it stays.
Yes.
And the wild thing is we can give life to it.
Yes.
By continuing to speak. Continuing to speak.
Amen.
Continuing to say. You know what? I've asked the Lord. There's been times in my life where I've asked the Lord, "I need you to give me words to say." We fight the good fight of faith. We fight with the Word of God.
Right.
That's our ammunition.
Amen.
We can't stand against the enemy without the Word.
Amen.
And we got to say it in faith. And we got to believe what we say. When we say it, and if you have to say it 15,000 times in 4 days,
Amen.
You say it until you get the victory.
That's right.
I had, and I shared this here a while back, when I was going through some of that uneasiness and just nervousness and stuff like that. I said, "God, I need you to give me some word. I know the word, I've been quoting scriptures, but God, I need something fresh. Give me something fresh, Lord."
Yeah.
And he spoke to me, he said, Galatians 5:22, so I went over there and it's the fruit of the Spirit. And the first one is love. First one is love. And I saw that, and as soon as I saw that, the Lord spoke to me and said, "I want you to, every time that comes up in your life and you start to feel that uneasiness, that edginess, I want you to tell the devil, 'Devil, devil, you will not rob me of my love, joy, and peace.'"
Yeah.
Amen.
Those were words from the Lord that he gave me to declare to say.
Amen.
And every time I do that, instant almost.
Yeah.
It leaves.
Amen.
That's the word of the Lord for me, personally.
Right.
He gives you ammunition. He gives you, we're prophetic. The devil cannot stand against the word of the Lord.
Yes.
It is written.
Amen.
There you go.
Amen.
It's said and done. It's established. The word of the Lord will never die. It will be established. And I really believe the word of the Lord is growing even as we speak. With revelation to us, believers, the body of Christ. Hallelujah. So we're a prophetic people. We've got to speak. We've got to say. We've got to know what the Spirit of the Lord is saying to us and declare it. Amen? So it says here that it's given to all. Verse 8, "For to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, to another the word of knowledge through the same Spirit, to another by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healings by the same Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another different kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. Now, I don't have time to get in there to dig in there about all the different, you know, tongues and interpretation and all that kind of stuff. Don't have time for that. But I will say this, that the gifts work through the ministry offices, the fivefold ministry offices.
Yes, thank you.
And I said it before when we were talking, that I don't fully understand that either myself, I'm just being honest with you, but I said earlier when I was speaking earlier that we all have a gift. We all flow in one of those gifts, one of those offices. The Lord will use us in one of those fivefold ministry gift offices. Whether it's apostle, pastor, evangelist, apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, or teacher.
Come on.
One of those gifts is yours. And if you don't know what it is, ask him. I guarantee you, he'll be very plain to you and show you. And then my advice to you is to stay in his presence and flow in that gift to how God has created you to flow in that gift. I love how the Bible says that we are all evangelists. Yeah. We're ready in season and out of season to do the work of the evangelist. We all can flow in that gift. And if that's the gift and you feel like that's where the Lord's got you flowing in, then folks, let me tell you something. There's plenty of people out there right now that can be evangelized. It's ripe for the taking. You don't need a building. You don't need an offering. You don't need any of that. Just go for it. See, that's one thing I found out about the Lord is when you're doing His work, He'll provide for you. And God's a God of more than enough. God's a God that will give you more than what you need, even at the time. And that's another thing, you just got to believe God and trust God in. He wants to bless you guys. Found out if you'll just be obedient. If you'll just be obedient, He'll take care of the rest. If you'll just be obedient, He'll take care of your family. I know He's got to work with people, and people make decisions, and they have their own, you know, ways and their thinking and things like that. But you just keep being obedient and keep speaking life and love and health and victory and freedom over your family, they'll come in, guys.
Amen.
God will get their attention. Just like didn't He get your attention? He'll get their attention. He's got a way to do it. He knows how to do it.
Yeah.
Amen. So these nine gifts here, they flow in the body of Christ as the Spirit wills, as he heads that direction. Now look, it says here in verse 11, but one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually as He wills. Now let me say this. If you have a desire to follow Christ, you're going to want to help somebody.
Amen.
You're going to have people on your heart. You're going to have people on your mind. You're going to have people that you want to bless and help and take care of if you can, or lead or teach or something. You're going to want to do that. And that's the love of God on the inside of you, because that's what Jesus did. He went about and He loved people. And if that's who we're following, we need to be a lot like Him and let Him minister to us and help us in that area. So if you're going to follow Christ, you're going to want to do those things. Now, it says that He's given to one as individual. He's given it to us, one of these gifts individually to us. Now, I believe that, you know, and if I'm wrong, Dad can correct me, but I believe that, let's just say you're walking down the street this afternoon, you're walking down the street, and all of a sudden, you look at somebody and you hear their right shoulder. That's a word of knowledge. That's a word of knowledge. You just heard the word knowledge. That's the number two gift, the word of knowledge. You heard it. It's a specific thing about a specific person. And usually when you hear the word of knowledge, or when you flow in the word of knowledge, it's usually because it's a need that somebody has. Right. Like right then. So you hear that, so you know you choose to do it or not do it, but if you go up to them and you say, you know, hey, I was just wondering, have you been having problems with your right shoulder? And they said, yeah, you know. Okay, well, The word of knowledge has been revealed right there. That gift has been revealed to that person. They might not even understand that, but you, by acting out in that, has just released the gift of God into their life.
There you go.
There's an anointing there.
Yeah.
You don't have to feel it, worry about it. Guys, it's there because you heard the Lord say it and you just released it. It's there. The anointing's there because of your obedience. Secondly, hey, can I pray for you? Sure. You lay your hand on them. You pray for them. All of a sudden, they're healed. Look, it's a gift of healings. There could very well even be a miracle gift that takes place there. Whatever, depending on the situation of the shoulder. If the guy could not physically, because he has some kind of deal in it, where he could, the doctor told him he could never lift his arm fully up, and all of a sudden the guy lifts his arm fully up, that's a miracle. You just work in the word of knowledge, the gifts of healings, and the gifts of miracles.
Yeah.
And miracles. And I know a lot of us understand this, but see, I think a lot of us don't really understand that we do flow in these gifts a lot, and we don't even recognize them.
Right.
Amen.
You could be riding down the street, all of a sudden you feel the gift of tongues come on you. Do you understand?
Yes.
And I've had this. I've been in a car with Dad, where all of a sudden we're talking about baseball, and all of a sudden he's like, shaka, bro, 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 so, bro, bro, and then a word comes out of him in English. Just come out of nowhere. We weren't having a worship service, and you know, we were just driving down the road. But that gift comes on. See, that's what we need to be open to. Because there's a purpose and a plan and a time and a reason why God does that. And we might not even see the fruit of that for another year, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 years. We might not ever even see the fruit of it. It might have changed somebody that was on the street 2 blocks from you, because God wanted us to release something in the Spirit that will send angels to help them to do what needs to be done. See, that's the spirit realm. I don't fully understand it, but I know that if I'll be led by the Spirit, God will get the job done because He wants to use us.
Yes.
And a lot of times, it's not for us even to know what the heck happened.
Yes.
It's just, He just wants us to be obedient, and then if He wants to share with us what happened, that's the cherry on top.
Yes.
That's great. Amen. I mean, I've heard story after story, you know, like Brother David said, it reminded me of, I've heard story after story about people praying for someone across the earth, I mean, across the other side of the world, and things happening. They come to find out later, God allowed that revelation to come to them that something happened there, you know, there was a connection or something. There's all kinds of stuff that happens. You could be in your house watching Dr. Phil or something, I don't know, you know. And God speaks to you, all of a sudden, you see your relative come across your face. And you start to pray for that person, you know.
Amen.
Just yield to the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Yield to the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Knows what He's doing.
Hallelujah. Gifts and manifestation makes the kingdom visible. We are called to make the kingdom visible, guys.
Amen.
We're called to make the kingdom visible.
Absolutely.
If you're open to the kingdom of God, He wants to make it visible on this earth that God is God and He is real.
Amen.
I'm never concerned about God proving who He is.
Right.
I never worry about that. I never get concerned about that. Because I know that He, just through my life and through other people's lives, your lives, on and around, I see that God is real and God is true and He is visible.
Yes.
That's what the world's hungry for. See, a lot of the millennials, they want, well, prove it.
Right. Yeah.
Or they want to see it. That's great. That's great if they want to see it. Because you know what? God will show off and let them see it. Because He loves them. Oh yeah, well, prove that God's God. Make that guy's arm grow out that was born deformed. God's like, okay. Want to challenge me? Great. He'll make that guy's arm grow out. He'll heal that guy in front of him. God knows where people are. God knows where your faith is too. That's another big thing. Where's your faith? Do you have faith for that to happen?
Right.
Do you want that to happen? Do you want to see that happen?
Yeah.
Listen, if it's of the kingdom and you desire it, God's going to give it to you.
That's right.
Oh, yeah.
I'm going to say that again. What did I say? That's what happens to me. It just comes out. If you desire the kingdom, he wants to give you the kingdom. Whatever he has in his kingdom, he wants to give it to you if you desire it. If you're driven by seeing souls saved and people come out of the gutter and out of drugs and alcohol, if that's your passion, then I say to you in Jesus' name, go after it. And you'll see the fruit of it. You'll see results. You'll have God use you more than you can even imagine that he was going to use you. If that's whatever's stirring on the inside of you, guys, go for it. Go after it. If you're getting out of bounds, God will put you back into bounds, you know? Don't be afraid to miss it. Don't be afraid to make mistakes. Don't be afraid of any of that. Just go for it, praise God.
Amen.
Don't worry if people like you or people love you. Don't worry if they think you're the best thing since sliced bread. Don't worry about any of that kind of stuff. Just go for the kingdom. Let it be visible in you. Let it come out of you.
Yes, amen.
That's Christianity.
Yeah.
It's not how many times we go to church. It's not how many Bible verses we know. That's all good. We need all that. We need both those things. But it's about Christ being visible in us.
Amen.
That's the deal. That's it. So, he says that verse 11, but one and the same Spirit works all these things, all these gifts, distributing to each one as he wills. As he wills. Now, this might seem off the subject for just a second, but this just keeps coming up to me right now. Listen, we've got to get out of the mentality that we go to church to be good in God's eyes. That's nonsense. Well, I can't, and I know people do that because I used to do that, number one. Number two, I can't go to church, lightning will strike. Lightning strikes already, it's called healing. That's what healing looks like when it comes. It's like lightning from heaven.
That was good.
Let the lightning come. I need it.
You got it.
We don't go to church to be good. We don't go to church so we can feel good the rest of the week. We go to church so we can fellowship and worship in corporate anointing together.
Amen. Amen.
So we can give up or receive from one another, get things from one another, different things that they have, your giftings, your love, whatever. We stir that all up in here. God says things. We get revelation. We get wisdom. We get knowledge. We get correction. We get things done. We hear things by the Spirit of God, things that we need that will change our lives. And then we go out and we give it away.
There you go. Yeah.
That's why we go to church. And it's good to have a pastor. I need a pastor. We need a pastor. We need somebody that has more spiritual wisdom than us. Because we need to look to them for help. And we need help sometimes. We need to know what's going on. Jesus is the true shepherd of the church. We understand that. But he also puts shepherds on the earth to help shepherd and lead. There needs to be a leader. Or leaders. That's even in the secular world. At your job, on your team, there needs to be a leader.
Yeah.
Or leaders. To keep things going. To keep things fresh. To have an understanding of what's going on. That's the same thing with the church. God sits, He sets those fivefold ministry gifts here on earth for the equipping of saints to help the people to grow in the things of Him. To grow in the kingdom. You might flow in that fivefold ministry gift of pastor to somebody who lives next door to you for a season. Come on, guys, get an understanding of this. Listen to this. You might be that pastor in that person's life for a year, and you live next door to them. You don't see yourself that way, but you find yourself flowing in that gift as you're talking to that neighbor. So we've got to be open to this.
Yes.
You might find yourself in that gift of teaching to your neighbor.
Yes.
They might just ask you question after question after question. How come? How come now? Why is this? Well, what does the Bible say about this? Or what, you know, and you might be that teacher in their life for a season to teach them something they need from the Word of the Lord. We can't just forget everything. Oh, I'm just who I am. God will use me however He wants to use me. And que sera, sera, whatever will be, will be. No, I'm saying today, hone in on the gift that's in you if you haven't already.
Yeah.
And I'll even go beyond and say this, even if you've already honed in on it, hone in on it more.
That's right.
And desire to be used in it more than you are now. Want more. Not for you, but to bless others. That's why. I've seen people pervert gifts for themselves to gain money, to gain whatever. And they don't last very long. But I've been around people that pursue gifts and desire those things because they want to bless the people, and they grow stronger and stronger and stronger in the things of the Lord. So there is an importance there that you're doing for the right reason. You desire the nine spiritual gifts to flow in your life because for the right reason, because you want to bless and help and love others.
Yeah.
God will most definitely use you mightily in those things. Amen?
Amen.
Now I heard Brother Hagin say this one time. Excuse me. Let me get over there. I want to quote it word for word. I wrote it down in here. Go to it. I remember when I heard this back in, I think it was like 2003 or something like that. When I heard him say this in a meeting I was at, he was speaking. Let me see. I know it's in here. I want to read it word for word, but I don't want to misinterpret it because it's powerful. Come on. Seriously? I know it's in here. I have so much written here. Hold on. Can someone sing the Jeopardy song? I got the answer, Alex. Just hold on. There it is. Okay, so I heard Brother Hagin say this. He said, if you try to operate in the Spirit and the anointing isn't there, the devil will accommodate you in familiar spirits. If you try to operate in the Spirit and the anointing is not there, the devil will accommodate you in familiar spirits. Okay, so that's pretty deep. I mean, that's pretty deep. I don't really know how to explain it because I see how I see it. It's hard to explain, but I have that quote. But let's put it through this way. If you try to just give someone a word of knowledge just because you feel like it and you want to impress them or something, and it's not anointed by the Father for you to do that because you really didn't hear him, you just felt like it.
Yeah.
And you try to flow in that, then you're opening up the door for some familiar spirits. Yeah. And they'll accommodate you with, he has an Uncle Dave, and he grew up, and all this kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And you'll hear all this stuff, because the demonic realm, there's familiar spirits.
Yes.
There's demons that were attached to your uncle and your grandpa and your grandma and all this kind of stuff. They know who they were. They'll accommodate you. But see, I do not, I'm just being honest, there's a lot of times I argue with God for a while before I give a word of knowledge out. Because I want to make sure that it ain't just me. Now, you can't get so far on the other end that you're just like so afraid to even step out and do something in one of the gifts of the Spirit that it holds you back. Because look, we will miss it. We will make mistakes. We will say something that maybe we thought we heard we did. That happens. God's not going to smash you for that. But He'll teach you something out of that. You know what I mean? So, you...
Sorry.
That's okay. The word's right there. It'll help you find what you need. you gotta remind me where I was at. I forgot what I was But you...
Not be afraid.
Not be afraid. You're gonna miss it. We'll miss it. But you continue to step out. Step out. It seems like, and a lot of you notice this, and it seems like the two veins that I really flow strongly in is the gifts of healing and the word of knowledge. And a lot of times those gifts of healings come from the word of knowledge.
Yeah.
That's a power gift attached to that word, a power gift of healing,
yeah.
Amen? And so, you know, there's a lot of times, some of you hear me say the strangest things. And believe me, trust me, to me it's strange too. And it's like, oh, really, Lord, you want me to say that? What, you know, I'm in a meeting here about a month ago with like 20 people here, and God wants me to speak out Lithuania. I'm like, God, who is that going to even mean anything to? Lithuania, there's like 20 people here, and I know everybody that's here, and none of them are from Lithuania. And more than likely, don't have relatives that live in Lithuania. I'm thinking this all in my mind, but I stepped out and I gave that word, and come to find out, my uncle lifted his hand, and I'm like, what does that mean to you? You know, he works at his work. The lady that sits next to the desk, her husband's from Lithuania, and she had been praying that he would get saved and born again like she is. So the Lord just targeted in on that guy.
Amen.
Through my uncle, and the reason why it was through my uncle is because he had the responsibility to go deliver and share that word with that lady and say, look, we just prayed for your husband for his salvation because of a word of knowledge in Madera from a guy that doesn't even know you.
Amen.
What's that going to do for that lady?
Amen.
That's going to encourage her, pump her up, excite her.
Amen.
That God is hearing her prayers and God's moving in this man's life. I mean, that's how God does those things. Right? That's like last Sunday. I mean, that was just wild, you know. I heard the number 39, you know, on last Friday, two Fridays ago. But God didn't want me to give it until Sunday morning. I gave that word that word out 39, and I knew it was a date. It was March the 9th, which was the Thursday before. I gave that out, and Donna came up, and her sister was, and I knew that it had to do with some kind of trauma or some kind of bad news that was given to somebody on that date. And her sister was diagnosed with gangrene. It was in her foot. The doctors were saying that they were going to have to cut that off and amputate. You know, and they just got that news on that Thursday, so we prayed for her. And then I had another word of knowledge. That morning, the word Willow Glen, and I had no idea what the heck Willow Glen was, but come to find out, it's the street that her sister lives on in another state. So see, I didn't know they went together like that. You know, and then within 10, 15 minutes later, I remember saying it on as by the Holy Spirit, call your sister right now, tell her exactly what just happened, because I know God is so specific about this, He's going to heal her.
Yeah.
I just know it. You know it. And then she came back in 15 minutes later and said, I just called my sister. When I called her, the doctor was walking out of the room exactly when I called her and told her that the infection has dissipated. He vanished, gone, nowhere to be seen on the MRI. And then she's going to be fine and she can go home.
Yes.
That's all within just, he gave me the word that Friday, and then Sunday it all just boom, just exploded and manifested. I would have never in a million years thought something like that would have taken place. And it all happens like this. You just stay open to it and be yielded to it.
Amen.
I don't get a word of knowledge every day. Sometimes, and this is how it works with me, but I haven't put boundaries on it. You know, I'm open to it happening more out in public and all that. I desire that, really, to be honest with you, to help people out in public, not just at church and stuff like that. Which is great. And it's starting to pick up a little bit as I walk around. I sometimes like hear things, but most of the time it's usually in this kind of setting for me. And that's okay. Because God wants to minister to His people too.